Welcome. Good evening, folks. Thank you for joining us either tonight or sometime during the week. We are here we're going to talk about true inclusiveness with Josh and Tier and Tony. Josh, would you get us started?
All right. Imagine when I sing this song that I'm a woman. I'm an old woman named after my mother. Old man is another child that's grown old. Dreams were lightning, thunder was desire. This old house would have burnt down a long time ago. Make me an angel that flies from Montgomery. Make me a poster of an old rodeo. Just give me one thing I can hold on to. Believing this living is just a hard way to go. I was a young girl, a cowboy, one much to look at, just a free rambling man. That was a long time, no matter how I try. Years just to flow by like a broke down dam. Make me an angel that flies from gum. Make me a poster of an old rodeo. Just give me one thing that I can hold on to. Believing this living is just a hard way to go. Flies in the kitchen, I can hear all their buzzing, but I ain't done nothing since I woke up today. How the hell can a person go to work in the morning, come home in the evening, have nothing to say? Make me an angel. Make me a poster of an old rodeo. Just give me one thing that I can hold on to. Believing this living is just a hard way to go. Believing this living is just a hard way to go.
That was perfect, Josh.
It's great.
That they ended Ozark with that song just made it like all the more perfect.
Ozark has
welcome new, everyone.
There's a new season of Ozark.
Oh yeah, no, the final episode ends with a dead character playing Angel from Montgomery.
You've already watched the new season?
I couldn't help myself, yeah. I didn't sleep and just watched it straight through the night. It ends on a very...
That's some pretty dark stuff to binge on.
And it ends on a really dark note that was just perfect too. So, speaking of darkness and sin, we're going to talk about Jesus. We're going to start with what are the numbers of the chapters here, Tier?
9 and 10.
Nine and 10 sermons, 9 and 10 in the original edition.
Yeah, true inclusiveness. And
Mrs. Durr, Brother Will, and the Word of Faith.
Yeah.
That's a hard sermon title to put in a bulletin.
That was preached at Virginia Theological Seminary commencement in 1999.
Is that the seminary?
Right here in the neighborhood. Yeah.
And the other school where she gave the first talk, Trinity Episcopal School for Ministry. I'm not familiar with that. Anybody else?
It is. It's Paul Zoll was the president or the dean or whatever there for.
Oh, okay.
Probably when she preached this, maybe. I don't think it's. It is no longer an officially recognized Episcopal seminary, but it does. It churns out really good preachers. I do know that. A lot of strong Episcopal priest preachers have graduated from there.
Or self consciously identifying evangelical school, because she keeps referring to in that sermon to we evangelicals.
Mm-hmm.
Because 1994, the term has become problematized
even more.
Yeah.
So folks, you know the drill. If you have questions or comments, leave them in the chat and the feed, and Tier will keep track of them as we go along. But Tony, we said we were going to turn to you as our elder non-United Methodist clergy person here. So the floor is yours, and lead us in a wise and illuminating discussion.
I'll do my best. It's an indication of something about our level of inclusivity that we turn to a United Church of Christ person as the only kind of non-Methodist here. But I'm grateful that you people include me, and
I also think because of you, we should ask for advertising revenue from Patagonia.
Oh, I just wear the same clothes all the time. And that happens when you get to be my age. And also, I'm in a friend's home where they're gone and the temperature is 55. So, but okay. So, so the first sermon, these two really go together well. Inclusiveness, what the title is, true inclusiveness. And then the other one is I think still on that theme and still on what Fleming means by inclusiveness. As we all know, I think inclusiveness, along with a few other words, has become a bit of a buzzword for, gosh, I don't know, maybe 20, 30 years now. And along with maybe diversity, what else is kind of in that linguistic lineup? Diversity, inclusiveness, acceptance, I don't know,
mm-hmm.
Something like that. I think
it goes back to Star Wars, Tony. It's the Jedi Knight. The Jedi Knight, justice, equity, diversity, and inclusion.
Oh, you know, the great thing about being with you people is that you have cultural references that I don't. I do have other ones, but they're all passe. But anyhow, I think when this kind of got started, it had a dual impulse. One was the attempt by principally it's been mainline Protestant churches that have kind of embraced this, and it's I think it was partly fueled by the want to reach out to the un and the de-churched. And kind of because people's perception of the church often was that it was not a very welcoming place, that there were barriers to entry, and that it was kind of a club for whoever happened to be an insider in this club. But then, mm-hmm. then I think it morphed under the kind of push of lesbian, gay, inclusive sexuality issues to really mean more of welcome and inclusion of gay, lesbian, and of course now it's LGBTQ plus. It's getting a pretty complicated alphabet soup, and so. In my denomination, I would say it kind of began a little bit with an attempt to be inclusive of the un and de-churched, but then it became kind of a way of saying that the congregation or the church was open and affirming was our language with respect to gay and lesbian people and bisexual and transgendered people. So it was an inclusiveness that was, or a diversity that was kind of specific. It didn't tend in congregations that I was had something to do with, it didn't tend to mean political inclusivity. It in fact, I would say that we became in the UCC more inclusive with respect to sexuality, but less inclusive with respect to politics. And maybe less inclusive as well with respect to class. I'm not as confident about that, but we tended to be more the, people who had the benefit or the curse of higher education. And there's a class correlation there. So it was a human enterprise. I mean, it was something that we were striving for with respect to certain kinds of inclusivity and as time went on, it had an exclusivity to it as well. And it became a little bit more like what Fleming describes on page 72 of my volume, that it was a way we distinguished ourselves from each other, and to some extent, a way that we claimed a higher virtue than those who weren't inclusive in the ways that we were. Mm-hmm. So she says, one of the great certainties about the human race is that we perpetually make distinctions among ourselves in order to judge ourselves and our own group more favorably than others. So I think, you know, on the one hand, we were saying, yes, we're inclusive. We want you to come, not feel that you can't come to this church. We want gay and lesbian people to feel they're safe here. But it kind of morphed into an inclusivity that was at the same time exclusive, and also that was claiming for itself a kind of higher level of virtue than the narrow or rigid or exclusive either evangelicals or fundamentalists. And in that sense, it was an unredeemed inclusivity. what Fleming tries to do in these two sermons is to ground inclusivity theologically, not as a human campaign or human aspiration or virtue signaling, but as an inclusivity that is based in God's radical acceptance of the ungodly, which is, or of sinners, which is, as she has said, and I've said, really the most inclusive category of them all. We all get into that category. We all fit. So there's a way in which her sermons here on inclusiveness are both an embrace of the mantra, but also a challenging of it in a very, to me, helpful way. I just add a little bit more here before I open it up maybe to some discussion. I recall going to the General Synod of my denomination, United Church of Christ, probably in the late 90s, and inclusivity was kind of on the agenda, and here it was primarily about race, and it but we approached it as a church, I would say, almost entirely sociologically, psychologically, and maybe politically. There was very little biblically or theologically, and I wrote a piece in the Christian Century complaining about that, and got a call from the person in charge of our synod who...
I remember reading that.
That was the last time I heard from anybody in the higher-ups in the UCC. They were disappointed in me. but I had recently done a commentary on the Acts of the Apostles, and it just struck me as odd that since so much of the Acts of the Apostles was really about the theological problem and the human problem of inclusiveness, that we went about this as if we had no resources in our own faith tradition whatsoever to engage these questions. That the only thing that was useful was coming to us from sources outside our own tradition. I don't mind drawing on sources outside our own tradition, but I think we ought to be informed by and in some sense enriched by and even critiqued by our own. I mean, so we've got the whole issue of the Jews and Gentiles in Acts, and then Paul, of course, is engaging those issues in his letters. So I just regretted that we weren't approaching this so much as the church, but as another civic group. And I think part of the reason we did that is that we were theologically, and this has been my concern about mainline Protestantism, that we've been theologically and biblically underfunded for a long time, and that we are tending to take our cues more from the liberal culture than we are from our own theological sources. And that we also, for that reason, tended to morph into distinctions in the old form of we have this figured out. We are the inclusive people on issues of race, sexuality, but we were kind of blind to the way that we were pretty exclusive in other respects, I would say politically and with respect to class. And that's because I think we saw this as a human virtue rather than, we saw it as a human work, a new law, rather than a gift of God's grace. And Fleming is trying in these sermons to ground our inclusiveness in the gift of God's radical grace for the ungodly, for sinners like us, liberal and conservative, Jew and Gentile, slave and free, male and female, so on and so forth. So I think we have something as the church to contribute to this conversation. And instead, we have often simply mirrored the polarization of the larger culture. I shall pause.
That's really well said.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening, everybody. See you next week.
No, I don't know. I mean, that's I mean, anyone who's listened to our podcast before will know. I mean, or just, you know, sermons around this. That's my biggest frustration is like we come at the, and it's not just issues of inclusion. It's we approach too many issues atheologically, and we kind of, you know, maybe we'll use like a Bible quote as the header, so to speak, but we don't really sound any different than someone on Fox News or NPR.
And the test is to, you know, do we have a place at the table or even a capacity to have conversations with people who are not in our political class world? Or do we simply sniff at the, you know, and right now, obviously, I mean, these issues have only become more radicalized, and more divisive.
I was thinking of this last week when I saw Ryan Burge, a Baptist statistician, share on Twitter some graphs of voting patterns by denomination. And it didn't surprise me, but I think it would surprise a lot of people that United Methodists and Mormons are identical in terms of how the average worshiper votes. But I feel like the institution of the United Methodist Church and a lot of mainline churches does not reflect does not reflect the people who are in their pews, that there's a complexity to the congregation and how they come about issues that isn't represented institutionally or maybe even in pulpits.
Yeah, I think there has been in my denomination as well, a pretty significant gap between the denominational powers that be who seem to have increasingly less power and the churches. That's not to say that one has it all right or the other all wrong or the other all right, but the thing about the inclusiveness that is pretty much becomes kind of a slogan, and I know for many people it's very deeply felt, it leads to self-righteousness. And I think the inclusiveness of the gospel always leads us to humility and to confession of sin. The righteousness is not our own. The righteousness is the righteousness of God to people who are always, me included, Fleming included, making distinctions between ourselves and people that we want to judge. And she uses this example in the next sermon of smokers and how she was a smoker. And
it's in this sermon, actually. Yeah.
It's in this sermon, the first one.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah. You're right.
It's so rich too, because it's John Shelby Spong shaming her.
who says something that he could never get away with if he's still alive. I can't stand women smoking.
Yeah. I love it because, I mean, she's using it as self-deprecating. She's putting herself as an example of me feeling superior over other people. And here's, for people who don't know, John Shelby Spong is kind of like, you know, this placeholder for that other view of we're too tight in our britches and we need to be more inclusive. And his reaction to her is, oh, I can't stand women smokers.
Yeah. Although he was younger then too, and may have been a little more less inclusive, but that's an issue around which I'm terrible. My parents were both basically chain smokers, and I can't stand smoking. Mm-hmm. And I'm very self-righteous about it.
Yeah. I'm like, if someone tells me they like the show Friends, I immediately judge them. It's just a reflex I have.
Yeah. But there are other issues around which I'm attitudinarian.
And what you said about, and I think it's her second sermon, and in Fleming's preaching, Will Campbell appears frequently in her crucifixion book as well, and I think she uses him in a he's useful in that if your advocacy for and preaching about inclusion does not provoke the people who are on your side to want to kill you, chances are it's not an inclusiveness that is informed by the gospel. It's informed by the world.
Yeah. Yeah. And of course that can take us back to Jesus's inaugural sermon where he, in the synagogue in, Nazareth,
yeah.
Where he basically takes on his own people and they want to kill him. And I think Will Campbell was a great prophet in that sense, and was notorious for being, on the one hand, serving as a chaplain to the Ku Klux Klan, because who were more ungodly than them?
Mm-hmm.
Who were more on the wrong side than them? But he was willing to, associate himself with them, and as he does in this anecdote that she, or this excerpt she tells here. And, you know, to my kind of liberal, that would be the most scandalous association there would be. And just beyond people's comprehension.
Jason, what's the name of that African-American fellow that collects Klan robes?
The what?
Oh, Daryl Davis.
Yeah.
Did
you summarize some of his witness as something that looks more like theological inclusion than
Daryl, he's a Christian. Daryl Davis lives in Maryland, Beltsville, Maryland, I think. Near here. Daryl Davis is a professional musician, has played piano in like Chuck Berry's band, he's just a professional musician that plays with famous people. And it's like at some point in one of his shows in Maryland, I think, someone shouted the N-word at him. And his response was you don't even know me. And so he just decided I'm going to get to know this guy. And lo and behold, they became friends. And so he discerned in that a calling to befriend people in the Klan. And he has since, collected a number of, robes and all the paraphernalia and shit from Klan members that he has led out of white supremacy. And what's interesting about Daryl Davis's witness is because it really does call out the sin of making distinctions, including a grand wizard, Kelly says. Yeah. I mean, so he's a legit dude. But he really does call out our love, you know, the laws wired on our hardwired on our hearts, right? So it's you like the reaction to hit him. There's a whole lot of white people who have a lot of unexamined racism that whenever you know, like a story like Buffalo like pops up in the news, and you want to connect the dots to like maybe like Tucker Carlson or just rhetoric in the public square, they'll want to latch on to like a black hero like Daryl Davis and say like, you know, like, don't be angry, black people, be more like him. And then on the other hand, there's a whole lot of African-Americans I know that if they hear about Daryl Davis's story, they'll lash out and say like, well, like, you shouldn't impose upon us the need to heroically forgive white people and be like him. In a lot of ways, he's like a black Will Campbell. Like that his very, like, when you think about it, like, simple yet impossible act of gospel inclusion offends people on both sides.
Right, right. And I should be clear, Will Campbell was not supporting or sanctioning the Klan, but he was saying by his witness, by his presence, that Christ has died for the ungodly. And that, you know, the it's easy.
That's a good point, because it, like, for Will Campbell, it wasn't even right. It wasn't even a matter of, like, he wasn't doing that with the expectation that he was going to change them. Right. It was just to bear witness to the message.
Yeah. 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 Last year, I'm out in northeastern Oregon, which is where my family comes from. It's a very rural area, ranching area. And last year, about this time, or I guess in June, there was a Black Lives Matter demonstration here in Enterprise, which is the county seat, which is where my grandparents lived and my parents grew up. And I went to this Black Lives Matter and demonstration. I brought 200 people. And across the street from the demonstration was at the courthouse. And across the street, there was a group of people, I think mostly men, carrying guns. And one of them had been up on the roof of the building with a long rifle, and the sheriff had gone over to him and said, "Come down." And so they're standing over there, and I thought about walking across, and they were menacing, and it was uncomfortable. And I thought about walking across the street and just hanging out with them for a while, but I didn't have the guts to do it. But if Will Campbell would have done that, or somebody with a little more gospel moxie than I have would have done that. But it's kind of that kind of thing. And right now we're really, I mean, literally standing across the street from each other, you know, some shouting slogans, some toting guns. And it's very hard for us to cross the line.
Yeah.
Now I would like to think in my preaching and other respects, challenge the verities of my own tribe, but it's a tense time, and it gets right to these issues. You know, do we see in people who are on the other side or in the other tribe, and in ourselves, a sinner for whom Christ died?
Yeah, I think there's something unique to what Fleming is doing here. And it's this, you know, we're talking about the, I think there's something unique to the sermon, right? There's a gift from God to both clergy and lay people to enter this space where we're going to, for the most part, listen to a monologue and concede that the word of God is mixed up in there. And that's something very different than, Tony, I've been in a Black Lives Matter march here in down Main Street in Orange as well. And I would say that I have this tension that people like Daryl Johnson and Will Campbell, I feel a certain affinity for their witness. And yet there are times when I don't feel called to that witness, you know, meaning like, you know, I could, walking down the street in the midst of a march that's with purpose and people shouting, there isn't a whole lot of time to get to know somebody, say, hey, why are you here? You know, let's chat. Sometimes those situations present themselves, and there's a difference between me being responsive when those situations present themselves or when I feel the nudge of the spirit. And there's also a human enterprise in me just wearing this guilt and saying, I need to construct those things. But there's something unique about this homiletical moment where she can ground this in the word of God and involve herself. She's a sinner like everybody else. And she can hold before us, bodies of believers who are coming from very different convictions from the same scripture, like in the first sermon when she's comparing the Corinthians to the Galatians. They're contextual. They're going through different things, and there's a word of grace for both of them. You can do that in a sermon. You can't always do that in a march.
And there's a word of judgment for both of them.
Yes, absolutely.
I want to tell a little story, and then I know Tier has something that I think shows how this works on all of us in a way that maybe isn't virtue. So I did a burial on Saturday morning for someone who had some sort of kind of tangential relationship to my church at some point, but she for like. Seven or so last years lived in Kentucky with her son and daughter-in-law. And so the family didn't want a funeral or anything. So I'd never met any of them. They all wanted to gather at the graveside at the cemetery on Saturday morning. And so Saturday morning is my first real interactions with any of them. And so I get out of my truck and I walk over to the grave, and a guy comes up to me, introduces himself as the son. And the first comment he says is, he's like, huh. He looks around like at, you know, the town. And he's like, there's a lot of Orientals around here. And I was like, oh boy, here we go. And so in my head, I'm judging him, you know, like that's all I'm doing. And I'm making all kinds of assumptions about everybody else under that tent in the rain at the graveside. So I do the burial liturgy, and before the committal prayer, I open it up to the family if anyone wants to say any last words. And so the same son gets up, and so they're all like super Appalachian. And so first son gets up and he's like, you know, mama was a good woman, but, and then in this most, in like anyone who's a pastor, like you get these moments, right, that make you want to be a pastor. Like he was able to name, in a very honest but not malicious way, all the ways that his mom was like pain in the ass, like vindictive, mean, you know, like all the stuff. So he was able to do that. And then he looked at his wife and he said, there was like almost 50 people there. He looked at his wife and he's like, I just want you to know that I'm so grateful for like you doing all the heavy lifting of taking care of her when she was so mean to you the last couple of years. And he's like, if I wasn't married to you, I would have fallen in love. You know, like he said this, like this, like the kind of like you don't ever see that, like hardly ever, right?
Yeah.
And then another son gets up, like the older, and then he looks at right at this woman, and he's like, on behalf of the whole family, I want to thank you for doing. And so like it just happened, and I was like, oh my gosh, like. This is the most emotionally healthy family I have ever like seen in 20 years of ministry. And it started with like a paragraph of racism that he shared with me. You know, he didn't know it was racist necessarily, but you know, and so there's this complexity like in people and in family groups and in congregations that when we take when we draw these lines and make distinctions, we're like cutting away parts of people, they're like his racist parts over there, but there's a whole other part about him that's over here on the good side. And like, you're not willing, you know, if you don't have an all-inclusive category, like the justification of the ungodly, you just got parts of people like severed in half all over the place. So Tier, I know, wants to share his story, because a lot of times, because the law is written on our hearts and we're hardwired to make distinctions among people, very often what looks like virtue, is operating on people in a very different way. So Tier, I've set you up.
Oh man. Yeah. So
is this where he confesses his favorite show's Friends?
I do. I do love, I don't love that show. It's one of those shows I'll watch when it's on, but that's not what the people came to hear about, Josh. Most people know that the United Methodist Church back in 2019 had an international sex conference where we gathered with delegates from around the world to talk about who could have what kind of sex, and then based on the kind of sex that you have, what your role in the church can be. And we as a denomination decided that certain kinds of sex are okay, other kinds of sex are not okay. And that's where we drew our lines. And so there was a lot of virtue signaling at our Virginia annual conference that following summer. The International Sex Conference was in February. The Virginia Sex Conference was in June. And leading up to it, there was a lot of work done behind the scenes to help make Virginia Methodist churches as inclusive as they could be. The problem with Virginia is also a blessing in that Virginia is very diverse commonwealth, politically, socially, religiously, all those things. And so there was this group, and I fully agreed that the Methodist Church needs to be inclusive of all people, that sexual orientation is not a dividing line within the church. But damn it, Josh, this group decided that the way to get this done and the way to get their voice out was with matching t-shirts. And if you didn't buy this damn t-shirt, I know. And if you didn't wear it at the prescribed time, this shirt that had an outline of Virginia done in rainbow with text that you couldn't read because a graphic designer didn't design it. I really wished you were wearing that shirt right now, Josh. So like I lamented to Jason about it. I was like, I don't want to spend the $22 or $30, how much this is going to cost me for this shirt to wear for this 5-minute session. 5-minute moment, one that I would never wear again, but then two, because it should not, and this ties back to what you were talking about earlier, Josh, it should not be t-shirts or going to some march that you have no personal connection to that changes our hearts. It's the work of God through the living word that we're able to read. It's through the work of the Holy Spirit that, you know, is contrary to popular belief, is still active throughout creation. And if it comes down to pressuring people through politics within the church, then I'm going to totally steal something Fleming told us on this topic back in 2016, Jason. I don't know if you remember this conversation. We were talking about inclusivity in the church. She flat out said that inclusivity in the church along the lines that we like to draw inevitably make the church more exclusive. We inevitably become the progressive church in town where everybody's welcome. But if you can't get on board with our progressiveness, then you need to go somewhere else. In the same way that if you are not on board with whether it's full inclusion of the LGBTQ community, ordination of women in the church, if you're not on board with that, yeah, you're welcome, but don't think you're going to change us. And we see that now in the way the United Methodist Church is siloing itself into these into an ultra conservative, right? As if changing the book of discipline like wasn't enough, like they're going to go create a whole other denomination based on exclusion in the church. And I'm sure it's not far behind for a more politically, theologically progressive wing of our denomination to be created as we continue to sort out our divorce proceedings. But here's the other thing that really irritated me. It made us look, because I wore the damn thing, it made us look like a middle school tour group going up and down the DC mall. That's really what it made us look like.
So I didn't know you called your annual meetings sex conferences.
That's just what we called it.
I just think that you know, I'm surprised the Methodist Church isn't growing more rapidly, if that's how you call it.
Right? Wouldn't you want to go to an international sex conference?
It's just a bunch of NPR tote bags with a Virginia logo filled with lube.
You know, I think you would get a whole different group. It'd probably be quite a bit more inclusive.
It most definitely would be. What Fleming shows in these sermons, but I think what makes Fleming distinctive across her work is her faith in the fact that it is the message of the justification of the ungodly through Christ that changes people. It's that message. That's how you change people. It's just get people to see themselves as the ungodly person who is undeserving of God's mercy. And that's not Tony doesn't do that. Tier doesn't do, like, that's not the job of the preacher to change people. It's the job of the preacher to be faithful to the message that changes people. And that's why someone like Will Campbell can be like kind of profoundly problematic, because he wasn't really that very nice to his family. And so the message of grace is what changes people. And what Tier is describing with his t-shirt story, right, is that the very good motivations of some people in the United Methodist Church led to an idea that then functioned upon Tier, not as gospel, but as law. Like he experienced that as a burden that he now had, in order to measure up, he had to wear this. And that is no different than conservatives and traditionalists on the other side of this issue and a lot of issues, who are not proclaiming the justification of the ungodly, but they're preaching, they're using the body, like in the name of biblical authority, they're proclaiming it's just a different law. It's just a different law. And so like both sides are exhorting people to be different. And that is experienced as a burden. Fleming is like almost myopically focused in her preaching on God justifies sinners in Jesus Christ. And she doesn't even make the promise. I don't think anywhere she makes the promise that if you believe this, you will be changed. She just trusts that that's how God changes people. Because the word of the cross is the power of God invading the world, right? That's like the beginning of Romans.
Well, and so much of this conversation so many of these types of conversations leave out God in general, right? And we default back to whatever political talking points we most recently heard or most resonated with us. And then if folks are lucky, they'll attach half of a Bible verse to it, or verse of scripture to it, completely taken out of context, of course. And then just send it out to the masses. And here's why you have to do this. Not for the sake of the gospel, not for the sake of really inclusion in the church of all people, but because if you don't, then you're I don't want to say one of them, because David Fitch's book about us versus them, like, really kicked me in the gut about using that type of language in the church. But for the sake of this conversation, it really kind of continues the work of siloing us away from one another, and I think more importantly and most dangerously, away from the gospel.
Yeah, for the benefit if you haven't, you know, it's not a requirement to read the book or the sermons to participate in this. So for the benefit of those who haven't, let me give you this zinger from the close of the first sermon. The gospel is more inclusive than anyone who does not know scripture could ever imagine. Who could have ever spoken of the justification of the ungodly and the undeserving except by revelation? We do not stand on our spiritual gifts, our religious habits, our extemporaneous prayers or right doctrines, our correct interpretations. We stand on only one thing, the grace and love of God. The gospel that she announces is what God has done in Christ, not what we do. Tony said before, you know, ethics is the response. Gratitude is a response to what God has done. But the good news is what God has done. It's not what we do. And anytime we get into that place where I'm high and mighty, I'm deserving, I'm on the right side, we're falling back on ourselves. And even when we're fuck ups. So Tier, as you're talking about wearing that t-shirt, I bought one of those shirts. And I remember, like, the second sermon, Fleming reading the prayer of confession and saying to herself, I'm a miserable offender, right? Because I not only was I allowed to go forward with this, but I experienced the law, and I also experienced the confession of sin and the grace that comes from saying, yeah, you did that. That wasn't great. That you're not winning hearts and minds with that. Let's move on from that.
That's really good. Bring up a mutual friend, I think, of yours, Jason, and Tier, and maybe Josh. Jason Biasi, I do some work for Vancouver School of Theology where Jason teaches. And, you know, Jason is kind of a church investigator, observer, among other things, and he writes profiles of what he sees. And he made the observation that if you want, if you want your congregation to have more older white liberals talk about inclusiveness, if you want your congregation to be inclusive and diverse, talk about Jesus.
Yeah.
And that really kind of sums it up here. And true. I mean, the church I go to most of the time in Seattle is an evangelical covenant church that is the most racially diverse church I know.
You go to an eco church?
What?
You go to an evangelical covenant church?
Well, I move around, but mostly the one I've been to of late has been in the last several years, evangelical covenant.
And okay. He's letting it all hang out.
What?
You're just letting it all hang out now.
And it's the most racially diverse church I've ever been to, and it's focused on Jesus. and you have sex for us in Jesus Christ.
And well, Tony, you mentioned your Acts book. So I remember reading the Christian Century article that you mentioned. And your byline led me to your Acts of the Apostles commentary back in the day as a whatever, you know, seminary and fledgling pastor. But, you know, like one of the things I remember realizing from reading your commentary on Acts is that if you look at the preaching of the apostles in the book of Acts, like it doesn't look at all like most of our preaching. You know, like Peter's not shooting on anybody in any of his sermons. It's like you know, you killed him, God raised him up. It's pretty simple.
Yeah.
And Peter isn't so one of the things I was thinking about when Tier was talking a second ago was Peter's interaction with the Roman centurion is not because he's trying to practice the golden rule, right? It's not something that he did. He's actually arguing with Jesus in his prayer time, right? Like, I don't eat anything unclean, you know, and God's like,
yeah. So so inclusion is not the content of Peter's preaching. Inclusion is the result of Peter wrestling with the message that he's preaching.
Right. Yeah. It's you don't exhort people to be inclusive. That's the law. You tell the story of broken, miserable offenders who are found by a persistent God
who breaks down dividing walls.
What?
Who breaks down dividing walls.
Yeah. And praise the Lord, God is doing something that the world cannot do, that the Democrats and the Republicans cannot do. And that's why we're here and not there. And you know, you mentioned the funeral, and it sounds like it was an amazing, wonderful funeral. I've come to hate funerals or memorial services because with the advent of the open mic, I mean, not only do they go on forever, but basically they do the opposite of what your open mic did.
Oh yeah, I hear you.
Come more fleshing out of the resume, more saying that the reason this person is surely going to be remembered and with God is because they're so wonderful.
I could rant about this for an hour.
It's all about extolling the person and not about extolling God, you know, but you know, it just goes to show in your story that all things are possible with God. God can.
And full disclosure, I created that space because I didn't have
no clue what to say about this person.
No, I didn't have a homily. It was just a thing on my calendar. Like, I know that sounds terrible, but it was a thing on my calendar. I was like, I'll do the burial liturgy. I didn't know this person. I'm not even going to try attempt a graveside homily. I'll just let them speak. And like, lo and behold, like, Jesus showed up and compelled them to be authentic in a grace-filled way. But like, I'm with you though, that like, funerals especially is where you see where like the effects of, how did you put it, that before, Tony, that were theologically underfunded?
Yeah.
Well,
we resort to what is it's our default option, which is to, because we hope people are going to say what wonderful people we were, we will say what wonderful this person was, which is usually there's some truth to that, but it's not the whole truth. And it's not like we necessarily have to spend our time saying, you know, actually this person was an SOB. Either, but just quit embellishing the resume, you know, I mean, it's like, geez, from preschool on in, we're just always trying to get into the group. And it's so
tiring. That's really a good way of putting it.
Well, to use the word inclusive or a part of the word, like, we want to be included. And we feel like if we don't have the you know, like you said, Tony, the accolades dating back to preschool, then we may not be considered included in this life. And then when we die, which is inevitable, like, we won't be included, or maybe remembered is a better way to put it there. So stock gets put into, you know, reading off Miss Betsy's obituary and her resume and whatever somebody wrote in her third grade yearbook about her. Instead of, you know, just talking about that, the good news that's in that is attached to us, because of anything we've done.
Our only hope in life and death is Jesus Christ, not Miss Betsy.
And if somebody brings up in that context in a graceful way that, you know, this person we're remembering and we love them and they had these good points, could be just a pain in the ass at this, you know, around this, everybody kind of is relieved because it's the truth about God.
Yeah. Well, it's why, you know, it's why, I told you I could rant about this, but it's the same thing, right? The clergy need to get out of the marrying business. Like, whoever calls the church, they'll do their, like, because you don't know whether they're standing up there in front of you, like, lying and making a mockery of the vows that they're going to make. And in the same way that, you know, like you don't want to, like, maliciously drag the dead, like, through the mud. But if a significant number of people in the room know that, like, they weren't, like, the perfect person, and you're, like, participating in a lie as the preacher, like, that has effects that go beyond the funeral service.
It basically says to people, if you don't lie about who you are, if you don't pretend to be perfect, God won't love you.
Yeah.
God doesn't love you. So it's just the same old song.
We talk about grace on Sunday, but now that so-and-so's dead, we're going to lie here.
And I know Jason knows the song that I sang up top. Do either of you know who wrote that song?
I know that it's Jason's favorite writer, and now I feel like I'm a bad
friend. How do you not know who wrote this song, Tier? How is that possible?
How can you be a human being that doesn't enjoy watching the show Friends? Shut up.
So the
guy, I always say there's a relationship between my love of John Prine and my distaste for Friends.
Oh, it was John Prine? I love John Prine.
That's a necessary connection.
So the reason I bring it up is John Prine wrote that song and performed it, but a lot of people associate it with Bonnie Raitt.
Bonnie Raitt.
She does a fantastic job with it. Bonnie Raitt says about that song, as a young feminist, back when John wrote this, says about herself as a young feminist, when I saw that he could tell the truth writing a song about a middle-aged woman, then I wanted to know more about who this person was. And she befriended John Prine and they were close, and she got to perform that song. And when John was asked about the song, he said, I just had this, he used to, when he got started out, first was he came home from the army and he was a mailman walking around Chicago, and he would go and play open mics in Chicago dives. And then he made a name for himself and became a professional musician. But he said, I had this vision of a woman with her hands soapy in a sink full of water washing dishes and just was fed up and walked away from it all. And that was the inspiration. That was the kernel for this song. And I think there's a reason why I played tonight, but right now there's something about telling the truth, right? Truth is truth. Right. There's something like you all have already said, you know, it doesn't mean we have to rake people over the coals. Doesn't we need to highlight all their faults, but there's something captivating about just bearing witness to the truth that is inclusive and draws people in.
When you tell the truth in the context of a confidence of a larger grace, mm-hmm. you know, it's not, let's tell the truth that this person was a you know, terrible person. It's let's be honest, but we can be honest because we are confident that there is a larger, persistent, relentless grace that is the first word and the last word.
Yeah.
And so, like, Tony, as a you know, church guru, like that show, like you show, that shows, you're pointing to is how essential and miraculous, right? It is that it can't just be the message that Fleming is preaching from a pulpit. That message has to be applied. You have to be intentional about applying that message across the life of a congregation so that the person sitting in the pew who hears Fleming preach that, but then is immediately judged in this or that or other venue. Like it has to be a play. Like people are only going to tell the truth if you know, you're attempting to make the whole church like an AA meeting, that there is a safety, like that the belief in God's grace is enough to create freedom in people to speak the truth.
It's a great book. And she'd be a good person for you to have on Crackers and Grape Juice by Molly Basquet, called "Standing Naked Before God," and it really tells about how they tried to make the moment of confession of sin in the church she was serving then real in a deeper way, where individuals would talk about something they a fuck up or a thing they were struggling with. And there's a line there somewhere between doing that well and just kind of and honestly, and it becomes more telling a truth, and on the other hand becoming kind of like Oprah moments or something where you're just going on about yourself. Yeah. And I'm not interested in the latter at all, but I am interested in the former. And I think in 12-step groups, they have some disciplines around so you don't just palaver on forever about what your screw ups. But it is, there is that context of a larger grace. But I would, that Standing Naked Before God, I think, is an important book, and you might want to
get
Molly for a interview.
Is she on the cover?
On the cover. Yeah. There you go.
So do we have any questions or anything
here? I really thought this would be the conversation where we would get the most Q&A or most Q for us to A. And we have not had a single question.
That's okay. So, but like, we have talked about it, but Tony, like, one of the things I wanted to make sure I asked you before we left is, do you have any wisdom on how to take Fleming's message that true inclusiveness, is the justification of the ungodly, how to take that and, apply it, programatize it, instill it into the life of a congregation?
Well, I'd like back to what I just brought up about this this study, Standing Naked Before God, and one congregation's attempt to get really honest, and they are influenced by the recovery movement in the prayer of confession portion of the service, where one person kind of hones in on saying, you know, I have a habit. I'm working to overcome it by the grace of God of lying. You know, and talking in some specificity about that, within a context, a liturgical context, a ritual context that made it a safe moment for that person and for the other people there, and not just going off on a captive audience. So I think programmatically that's one place I've seen that that I think deserves look. Now if you're going to attempt something like that, I think you need to remember the admonition of one of my mentors, Lauren Mead, who said the church has a habit of trying to put a $20 plant in a $1 hole. you'd have to recalculate that for inflation. But what he meant by that was we come upon something that looks good, and we just try to download it instantly without doing the preparation. And I think you've got to do a lot of preparation for something like what Molly describes in that book. You've got to do a lot of, tilling the soil. But I do think that would be one place I would go if I were going to try to incorporate this more into the life of the church. I think a variation on that is inviting people. I did a thing, last church I was at was kind of like, they told me nobody would come in the summer. So we started this thing between the services called Faith Journeys, which I'm not sure I like that title anymore, but basically it was just trying to invite people to talk about their experience of God's presence and God's absence in their life. And, so that at the end of a 20 or half hour talk, people were not in the, I agree with that, or I don't agree with that mode. They were in the mode of, that touched me, or that connected with this part of my life mode, which I think is where we need to be more. And my kind of church, we tend to be in the, oh, I agreed with that, or I disagreed with that, let me tell you why mode.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can I name something explicit too? Again, if, just for the sake of the conversation, but also if people haven't read the sermons, and this is building off your comment, Tony, about the $20 plant and a $1 hole, not doing the prep. Yeah. Paul is preaching contextually.
Absolutely.
And Fleming is holding that before us. And one of the things that's interesting that she does in this first sermon is she will take the same line and finish it differently.
Mm-hmm.
So she says circumcision is nothing, uncircumcision is nothing, and then finishes it differently for each of these congregations. Now, if you were a church and you were saying, I'm looking at the word of God, and we're doing a study on 1 Corinthians this summer, right? And we went through a close read. You might come out with a different vision than if you did the book of Galatians and did a close read. It doesn't mean, there's gospel in all of it, but she's holding before us that Paul's looking at this congregation and saying, they need this kind of prep work, and this group over here needs this kind of prep work. And we all too readily will just say, oh, that looks shiny, let's do that at our church, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. Instead of examining and saying, what's going on at the heart of this congregation? What's the gospel word that we need to hear, and how do we kind of adjust our lives to that? Because somebody, it may be, let's get really truthful and bare our souls, and others, it may be like, you need some more structure, because you're just too loosey-goosey and enjoying your freedom. And one of the things, I'll say this last thing and I'll shut up. In the Corinthian text, one of the things I love is Paul will say explicitly, not everybody is called to marriage. Marriage doesn't solve your problems. Right? Marriage doesn't make you happy. And the people who do find joy in it, it's through a lot of suffering, right? And there are people who never know the joy of marriage, but they know a joy in Christ. And there's people who just know loneliness, right? Marriage isn't the point. The point is that the thing that we're given is Jesus Christ. and how are in every avenue of our life, how are we matching our calling with the gifts we're given from God?
That's good. That's really good.
I do think that we ought not lose that, what you brought up again, Josh, the way she masterfully handles the difference between the Corinthians and the Galatians. I think that in most of our congregations, we have both. And to some extent, you could say the culture war today is a clash between the Corinthians and the Galatians.
Good Lord, yeah.
and you know, it's the libertines versus the ascetics or the, and we just keep hammering on each other, and we both need grace, and we both need a little bit, you know, something that the other side actually has.
Amen.
Yeah. I sometimes think that, like, quoting Paul on, like, you know, when he's writing about occasional things, like quoting him is like speaking to everyone on everything for, you know, at all times, is it's like can you imagine, like, if you took Paul's inbox and just turned that into the Bible, like because that's essentially what you're doing. It's like, does tier one to be accountable for every email he's ever sent on any topic? Like that's crazy. Like, you got to, like, look for, like, what are the main themes? Like, what are the recurring patterns?
What's that line you quoted in your blog the other day, Jason, from Cardinal George? We're a society that permits everything and forgives nothing. And that's why it's not a very gracious society at this point in time.
I know we're winding down. But we just got two questions in within a minute.
Oh, cool.
Of one another. So we don't have, Tony doesn't have to carry us anymore. Anonymous attendee asks, is it one way to,
Is that possible? Someone's anonymous?
Anonymous.
Okay.
I don't know.
Just one way. What?
They want to know, isn't one way to get what you are describing is to focus on the extent of grace, how indescribably large that grace is.
Sure is inclusive.
Yes, because what I was actually trying to, like, say before you interrupted me. Now I'm just, you know, like in that passage at the conclusion of the sermon that Josh read, you know, like what Fleming's talking about is, like, this message is only possible by revelation. Mm-hmm. And therefore it's careless for churches to just cast it aside and parrot the world's messages, but it's also, like, cruel to expect other people who aren't Christian to just, like, oh yes, I'll do the things that you, like, I should do, like, and so they're, like, you know, like, the miraculousness of the gospel message means that the church should steward it at all costs, like Paul says in 1 Corinthians. And it also means that we should have some, like a whole hell of a lot of patience towards people, like, for not embodying it, because it only comes to us by revelation. So, mm-hmm. So like, no, like, literally no one on earth is hardwired to embody this message. Show a little mercy and patience to people who, are drawing distinctions all the time. Well,
and the one person who was able to do it, who did do it, we killed him. Yes, for doing it. Okay. So the second question, from Miley Grigg, is the purpose of telling the truth mostly to judge, correct, convict, as well as rescue and save? Can the truth create and lead to exclusivity?
The purpose of telling the truth is to create the freedom for other people to tell the truth, and for the person who just told the truth to experience the freedom that comes with knowing that they are loved through the grace of God.
Because that's the ultimate truth.
There, because if the purpose of telling the truth has any other end in mind, then it is transactional, and it's just another form of the law. So you're not promising that, like, you're not, like, Josh is not telling his congregation, like, if you tell the truth, this is going to happen in your life. That's just a positive prosperity form gospel of the law. And so you're just telling them like, we're going to tell the truth here because like we've already been forgiven by God and Jesus Christ. And so none of us have a right to judge each other because we've all already been judged.
Yeah. I'm not intentionally trying to judge people. The word can leave us naked before God, but it also holds us with the grace that Tony was talking about. So example, this last Sunday, in our worship, Paul was preaching to the Athenians and he was saying, I look around and I see idols everywhere. We close the sermon with God's desire is for those who desire idols. So in that one word, it's naming both my tendency to worship things that are not God, but God's desire overriding that and loving me even in my sin. So God's desire is to love those who desire idols.
The idea of standing naked, like it's to you can stand naked before God because you have been clothed in Christ's righteousness.
Amen.
You know, it's bearing witness to the truth of the gospel and baptism. The more true thing about you is not what you did, but what God has done to you through water and the Spirit.
That's a good note to end on.
We did really good tonight.
I'm not going to lie, guys. I was nervous about this one just because,
really?
just because of where we, the three of us find ourselves.
What I like about this is that like we've now done this enough. We're kind of getting a rhythm together. Like we've got like, we're getting good at this together. It's like a four-person dance.
Next week, I'm a very task-oriented person.
I was just going to say that.
And that's why we need you, Tony, because one of us is not.
Why all the theological apparatus is Fleming's question. Isn't it enough to just be loving?
Boom.
Bless your heart.
Which means
take a long walk off a short pier.